when you have kids, you do expect them to grow up over time, eventually. Yes? Jonathan knows, yes? You've had kids too, right? And they survived?
I was happy to have them grow up. I mean, I consider parenthood just a transitional phase where I get the enjoyment of sharing my life with a young one and transferring whatever knowledge and wisdom I might have to them in some minuscule way. And hopefully that rubs off on them so they can make good decisions for the rest of their life.
Kind of impressive when it actually does.
Right, right. And I get that enjoyment just simply by interacting with others, too, just sharing socially with somebody, right? And seeing
this is absolutely
that form of their flower blossom in their life. You know, if I was able to share something with somebody and it was meaningful to them and they used it somewhere else and grew from it, then, yeah, that's awesome. It gives me a my own kind of self-fulfilling...
Well, we're talking about meaning of life, and I think when you talk about how you escape from the mundane, I ask you that? I don't think so.
Yeah, that was the quiz.
So, how do you escape from the mundane? Some of you respond with by learning and passing that on to others. And, you could do it through art too, but that's kind of interesting. Tonight we're going to discuss Nietzsche on the one hand, and then the second part we'll be talking about Anselm and other medievalists. So we're radical separation here. Nietzsche's one of his most famous lines is God is dead, and Anselm's most famous argument is the proof that God exists. So this should be fun. We did talk about Anselm's proof a little bit already, one of the evenings.
Yeah.
I don't know if you followed up on that yet, but we'll look at that again tonight, but I think in a little more serious vein, the aorta, that's not a vein. But we'll also discuss other medieval philosophers in general, too. But Nietzsche first, and Nietzsche kind of follows a train of thought that we've already discussed with Susan Wolf and Schopenhauer. In fact, Nietzsche was influenced by Schopenhauer. So when we think about the impact of the modern Enlightenment on the Europeans, we see them heading towards Darwin. Hegel is going to be part of this. In a sense, we're skipping Hegel for now, except for a few mentions of him. But he's really central to what happens at this point, too, because we think of Schopenhauer as a reaction to Kant that ignores Hegel. And I think I mentioned that Schopenhauer, as really a student, was mentored by Hegel, but rebelled against Hegel's philosophy, and in even his PhD thesis, arguing against Hegel's philosophy and philosophy. And Hegel literally accepts it as an acceptable PhD thesis and encourages him despite the differences they have. So that's kind of yay for Hegel and bad for Schopenhauer, you know, poor taste on Schopenhauer's part. But I mentioned, I think, I always do at least, that Schopenhauer promised within 2 years Hegel would have no students, but within 2 years Schopenhauer had no students, and Hegel's classes were always packed. It was very, very popular.
It kind of reminds me of a quote I remember seeing. Never, ever, ever get in the way of your enemy making a fatal mistake.
Yeah, let them do it. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, so basically, like, Hegel's like, sure, go ahead, do whatever you want.
They're going to
make
charge,
a fool of yourself if you want.
They're
going
to charge down that hill? Okay. Go ahead. See you when you come back. Mm-hmm. That's Napoleon. But so Schopenhauer, kind of angry, can certainly view him as an angry young man, and his philosophy is always depressing and so on. He never said that the cause of it is entropy. That's totally me coming from a contemporary point of view that says, well, you know, Schopenhauer wasn't too far off, because it does seem like nature just constantly wants to play tricks on you and screw you up. We can call it Murphy's Law and all the corollaries. Those are great. You're familiar with those, right?
Murphy's Law.
Murphy's Law. Okay. Whatever can go wrong will go wrong, and it always goes wrong at the worst possible time, etc.
I was EOD.
Oh, okay.
And that was like our, you know, our...
Dangerous.
What we lived by.
How did you live through all that?
Murphy's Law in mind.
I think 90% of all NASA rocket engineering is also Murphy's Law. It's just trying to counter Murphy's Law. Similar reasons. Things go wrong at the worst possible time.
These O-rings can freeze. It's okay. It won't be that cold.
O-rings freeze. Things fail to ignite. Things ignite when they're not supposed to.
Everyone knows the O-ring reference. The O-ring.
Yeah.
Maybe not.
Show. The young ones might not.
Yeah.
I remember it from sixth grade, so.
Yeah. Is that what caused Challenger?
Yes.
Yeah.
The O-ring contracted some, which made it leak, and the fuel leaked, and then that's what caused the explosion. So, Murphy's Law. It could go wrong. Well, it did go wrong. But that strikes me as entropy. Entropy is much more complex, so those of you, you know, that responded to that quiz question know that entropy is much more complex than just saying, yeah, life fights entropy. You're right. Life makes use of entropy. Entropy is involved in our destroying other organisms in order to thrive off of them, etc. You know, so, and in a sense, we're not closed, we aren't closed systems. So, in a way, we don't have to worry about entropy shutting us down. How on earth do we keep living despite thermodynamics, the way it works? Because we are eating, we are inhaling oxygen, and we're getting energy in lots of different ways. So we're not a closed system, obviously. But boy, you stick something in the refrigerator and you can just watch entropy take place, right? You know, within not too many months, it will look very different than it was when you first put it in there, right? That could have been really funny if you were thinking bacon, cottage cheese, or whatever you want to pick, right? But still, I like to think that when I first read Schopenhauer and was reading, the will, just some nebulous thing in the universe called the will, which is just out to screw everybody, screw up all your plans and everything. It just sounds ridiculous. And yet, at the same time, if you think, well, but the element of reality to it that makes everyone feel like Schopenhauer's got something there is, of course, explained by what? Something in the universe that frustrates you and things.
No, I was saying basic thermodynamic laws in terms of how we'll try to just for
so. Yeah.
I just comment that nature doesn't care what happens.
Right.
It's just looking for expression. So it's the human mind that puts the judgment on whether something is out to screw you, right? So
paranoia.
It's really nature just exploring potential based on the existing principles that are in place. It's the human mind that puts the judgment of the good or bad on the outcomes of the cause and effect. Nature is just interested in exploring it infinitely.
We're actually, life is part of nature too, of course.
Right.
So life is exploring nature on its own, and it seems like there are competing influences, or one way or the other. A lot of really interesting stuff about how life just keeps growing and becoming more complex. Stuart Kaufman, I think I've mentioned him a couple times. I got to meet him years ago when Alaska had money. Ted Stevens had earmarks, and one of those earmarks was a lot of money that went to the University of Alaska Anchorage in order for us to have speakers come up and as members or speakers for the Complex Systems Group, which the website is still there, and looks great. I don't think anyone does anything. So the web page is there. It never went away. But what's the latest? So it died in 2014. As you can see, no more schedule after 2014. And I'm sure there's no one answering the phone, etc. But what we did go away.
You got the one in the center wants attention first. There's a window in the center. Say no.
Yeah, I don't
go through a whole other thing.
I'm not allowed to anyway. I'm not an IT. The IT person. It would just screw us up for the rest of the evening. But so Stuart Kaufman was here, and the way the schedule worked, they paid these really fantastic speakers to come up from all over. He came up from Santa Fe, and he gave a Thursday night lecture to anyone that wanted to come, like and listen to it. We had it in the arts building, the big Arts 150 or whatever. Big interested group of Anchorage people that were interested, not just students. And then Friday, he would give a special presentation to those that were willing to listen to his hard science lecture, which was always interesting too. And then that afternoon, we would be able to go out and eat someplace. They would host him somewhere. And that particular occasion was the first time I got to eat up in Girdwood, up on restaurant, what is it, Seven Glaciers or whatever, the Alyeska restaurant up at the top, whichever one it is, I forget what it is.
Seven Glaciers.
And so that was a real eye-opening experience just to be able to go up there. Normally I wouldn't be able to afford it, but UAA paid for the dinner and I got to sit right next to Stuart and talk with him the whole time we were there. And he was just absolutely amazing. And he joked in his lectures about how the fourth law of thermodynamics is that everything keeps getting more complex, which that's not really a rule, a law of thermodynamics. But that really does seem to be the case, that things just keep getting more complex. Politics gets more complex. Anything you delve into, you want to find the black and white solution to it, so you start digging in the hole and you discover that the more you dig, the more hole you find. That's just the way.
Yeah, there's nothing down.
Yeah, you just keep finding, wow, it's more, even more interesting. The more you dig, there's more stuff, more atoms, more quarks, more string theory. What are we going to find next? It's endless, hopefully. hopefully is endless, because otherwise you're out of a job after a while, right? That's kind of interesting. But so entropy strikes me as an adequate, you know, contemporary explanation for it that he wouldn't have had, that Schopenhauer wouldn't have had. And Nietzsche, in reading Schopenhauer, and you know, it's a shame. Did any of you get to see the video that I posted that doesn't work now? Anyone notice? If you went to the syllabus, I won't mess this up by going back. But there was a video link to a BBC special that Bethany. This is it. The only thing is, this version is in Turkish. And it really is, too. They dubbed her out so that you can't hear her. So, you know, sometimes foreign language ones, you can just ignore the Turkish. But no, this one is totally Turkish. They've completely done that. And the English one disappeared, and I'm afraid it's my fault. So if you were hoping to watch a really great BBC presentation on Nietzsche, I feel like I screwed it up, because I watched it again Tuesday night to refresh my memory about it before my class on Wednesday. It's a duplicate of what we're doing right now. And it worked beautifully. And I watched the whole thing, and in fact, then when that was over, I went and I watched one on Einstein. It was great, and so on. So I had a great time. And I thought, you know, this is so good, I ought to share it. So I posted the link to it on my Facebook page. And then the next morning I came in for my class and I clicked on the link and it came up and said, this has been removed because of copyright issues. So I screwed it for everyone. Entropy, you know, or Murphy's Law, more likely. You know, I don't see how entropy could have gotten that. But in any case, sorry about that. That was really a great video, but you might be able to find it out there. I realize that means that BBC must think we're stealing it from them, because we're not paying for it. Maybe there's some way you could actually watch it and pay them.
All you have to do is put a fair use notice on it, especially because it's for educational purposes.
I don't know where to find it, except for if I Google it, and there it is. I mean, that's how I first found it a long time ago, actually.
It wasn't hosted on your page then?
No, those links.
On your YouTube channel?
No. I don't post those, but I link to them on my syllabus. And by the way, those are hopefully meet the requirements of the university, right? Every resource I use that I suggest or require, and I don't really require it, that you watch it, has to meet a criteria for access for everyone. And I don't know that they do, actually. But this is in Turkish, so I'm sure it doesn't meet anybody's requirements.
O çamların derinden gelen sesleri kulağımdan hiç çıkmayacak. Kilisenin boşluklarında çınlayan orgun sesi gibi. Nietzsche içindeki muhteşem zeka ve ilham.
So for example, this is Bethany Hughes, by the way, who's the BBC uses her a lot. She's written a book on Cleopatra. She's written a book on Socrates, the Hemlock Cup. I don't know other books that she's written, but she does a lot of these kinds of things for the BBC. And by the way, she's sexy, so it's fun to watch her. That's not offensive, is it, to say that? But I think she's sexy. I'm not going to run for the Supreme Court, so. You know. But so this is a bust of Nietzsche, right? That's, I think, pretty close to what he looked like when he was an infant. Tell, you know, Germans, they're born with a mustache like that. No, I'm just kidding, of course. But notice she's holding a picture of Hitler standing in this room with that bust. So that's a rather famous picture. I think the next.
Kayna olduğuna inanıyordu. Ama Nietzsche bunu görseydi, dehşete kapılırdı.
So the point she's making right at the beginning to try to make sure the audience will continue to watch the show is that there's a connection with Hitler. Remember, I also mentioned that connection with Schopenhauer too, because the concept of the will certainly is going to influence the Nazis. Shakespeare, remember the will of the triumph of the will, that famous movie by Leni Riefenstahl, which is still a classic. Even if you hate the Nazis, but it's a classic educational experience on how to use the media in order to propagandize a particular point of view.
I was going to say, actually did a quick little bit of research on the film, and it's been referenced all the way. They still use it for reference material. Major producers still use it on various visual effects.
Speaking of Hitler, didn't Wittgenstein go to school with...
Yes, he did.
Yeah.
There's a... Did I show you the picture of the two of them sitting in their class picture?
I think I was here.
That's easy to find. Your picture. You want close up, or what's cute is that Hitler, even though he's just a child, there has his little mustache. No, I'm kidding. He doesn't. So yes, and lots of imagine jokes about Hitler. He wanted to be an artist. Couldn't get the trees right, so damn, I'll kill everyone in the world. He couldn't get the picture. No, that's Eddie Izzard. I steal this. I'm mentally ill. You can tell. But so she is. Pardon. Squirrel, right?
It's okay. You never know where the will is going to lead you.
No. Unless your wife is involved, in which case, you know it will be good.
Yeah, some
do what the wife says, and you will be okay. I highly recommend that. That's real honest. I know it might seem like a joke, but actually, if you're male, find a woman who will marry you, smartest one that you can find, that will marry you. Which could be the limiting factor. You see how that works.
Too smart for you.
And then once you successfully get her to say yes, you know, at the altar and everything, do what she says. You know, it doesn't help if you marry a smart woman and then you ignore her. You know, the point is you do what she says and you will be much better off. Believe me, it works. I'm sure that had I not had the good fortune to be married to Donna, long ago I would have ended up a homeless dude under a bridge someplace, you know, for sure. Okay. But so, Hitler would have been much better off. Can you imagine if he had met Eva Braun before all this happened? And if he had listened to her, she probably would have kept him from going into Russia. 9, mein Führer, das ist dumm. Tut es nicht. In any case, the connection with Nietzsche is absolutely there. We might guess that there's a connection with Schopenhauer because of the triumph of the will and kind of impact that Schopenhauer had, but not only does he influence Wagner, that I did talk about in class, but he also influences Nietzsche. So when Nietzsche gets to the point where his father has died, and he's, so this is Nietzsche, this is, I'm back to Bettany's.
Bu kutsal metinlerin orijinalliğini akıl almaz bir şekilde çürütüyordu. Nietzsche üstünde de çok önemli bir etki bıraktı. Babasının ölümü ve çektiği acılar duygusal olarak Tanrı fikrini sordu.
She is sitting in the room where he would have been studying at the seminary and talking about the kind of text that he would have been reading at the time. And he's reading what for them then would have been a contemporary critical analysis of the scriptures, and that opens up his mind to doubts. So while he was a child, his father was a Lutheran minister, and he himself was absolutely impressed by the, what we might call the mysterium tremendum of, you know, the church, the escape from the mundane that is really the more traditional, is going to church on Sundays, you know, because you feel the structure takes your mind up away from the mundane, the music lifts your spirit up, you know, everything is up and away from the here and now, right? So if you think about how all the rituals are constructed and everything else, that's very clearly, in retrospect, analyzable as an attempt to take you away from all of this and remind you of eternity, that's eternity up, you know, figuratively up there, right? And this is the now, or the secular, right? The second by second. And Nietzsche was clearly swept up in that, following his father, even though he was very upset with what God did to his father, because his father had a horrible couple of years as his brain deteriorated, he lost his eyesight, went mad, and eventually died. When his autopsy was done, he was missing a good quarter of his brain. So whatever he had, it was eating his brain away. And by the way, Nietzsche always had headaches, migraines, poor eyesight, and was very afraid that he was going to eventually end up with the same thing his father did. And guess what, actually? He does. He ends up with a brain disease of some sort and ends up.
The sun
light.
Is right behind you. It's blinding me. It's so strange.
Go away.
I wasn't trying to get your attention.
It's going that way.
It's going that way? Yeah. Well, that screwed up.
You can close the curtain.
I can close the curtain.
That's is it that one? Or is it this one?
It's the one right behind him. Yeah. Thank you.
How do we know that what Nietzsche died of?
Well, you can pull the string.
Well, he lost. How's that?
That's right above where it needs to be.
Almost.
I'm sorry, about like 6 more inches.
Yeah.
Thanks, sir.
Salvation.
It's really difficult not making a joke after I heard 6 inches. But I didn't. You know, just, however, I have some self-control. Not much, but some. So, now I, you know, after talking about 6 inches, now I don't remember what we were talking about.
I asked, how do we know what Nietzsche died of?
Ah, good question. He does go crazy. That happens in Turin. Famously, he's out in the street and he sees a man beating a horse in the street that has fallen down, and the man just keeps beating it. And Nietzsche runs over and drapes himself over the horse to protect the horse from the man with the whip. And he never recovers from that and ends up going into an asylum there in Italy for, I think, a couple of weeks. Then he's sent home. He ends up living with his sister, and his sister took care of him the rest of his life in that same building where Nietzsche visited the sister, and by the way, she gave him a cane, a walking stick, gave Hitler Nietzsche's walking stick. It was a picture of
that
being presented to that's Nietzsche's sister in a lovely hat. She's giving Hitler Nietzsche's walking stick. But by then, Nietzsche died. I think he died in 1900. So, 1889, at age 44, he suffered a collapse and a complete loss of his mental faculties. He lived his remaining years in the care of his mother until 1897, then with his sister. He died in 1900. Forgot about the mother. It's interesting. But meanwhile, the sister is also going to edit his last work, The Will to Power. And she was a supporter of the Nazis and made sure that that work seemed to support the Nazis. But the book that Hitler especially was fond of was Also Sprach Zarathustra, which is Thus Spake Zarathustra. Who is Zarathustra? Zarathustra is probably Zoroaster, the Persian prophet, where the Magi come from. In any case, let me go back though, because his father died of a mental illness that scared Nietzsche the rest of his life. Plus, he had problems. The thing that got him was studying the scripture, as you saw in that one frame where she's pointing out that his studies in the seminary is what changed his mind, and so he ends up losing his faith and end up convincing his sister to lose her faith as well, by the way. And the mother was mad at him. But then he goes off and he's interested in philosophy instead. Let me see where. That's
some
all
interesting
in this video.
Freudian elements there. Father dies.
En önemlisi sonsuz kurtuluşun artık insan o.
Okay, so here she is in a bookstore. I don't know if it's the bookstore that he found the book in, but she's reading Schopenhauer's book, and that's when Nietzsche becomes a fan of Schopenhauer and ends up feeling like Schopenhauer is just describing his mind, his life, Nietzsche's life, with his book. But he does disagree with Nietzsche, and that is on Darwin. He doesn't feel that Darwin is correct. When Darwin talks about the survival of the species, you know, the survival of the best, right? Oh, survival of the fittest, right? Actually, Darwin didn't say. It was Herbert Spencer, wasn't it? Herbert Spencer, I think.
Herbert Spencer. I remember his nickname, Darwin.
Herbert Spencer.
And who disagreed with Nietzsche about Darwin?
Schopenhauer? Well, Nietzsche disagreed with
Schopenhauer.
He had some disagreements with Schopenhauer, too. I'm trying to think if one of them was his disagreement with Darwin. And he basically accepts Darwin, the idea of evolution, and an important part of Nietzsche's thinking is the Übermensch, right? Which is, everyone's familiar with the Übermensch to some extent. You've heard the expression, no?
Heard the expression, I don't know what it means. Super monster?
Superman.
Oh, okay.
Superman. Mensch is a man. In fact, they even use that. Be a mensch, you know, be a man.
It's sort of the idea of an elite human.
Right. Oh yeah,
and Hitler wanted that to be the Nazis. Wanted the Übermensch to be the Schutzstaffel, the SS, right? His elite guard, which lived in the barracks that I lived in when I was in Berlin for the first 3 months, which is interesting. But for Nietzsche, the evolution that leads to the Übermensch is not a biological evolution, but a mental one. But he also disagreed with Darwin in the sense that it's just the point of evolving. So basically, what's the point of living, procreate, and die? You know, that's it. You know, but for Nietzsche, the point of living is to accomplish something fantastic. Will to power is the will to have meaning in your life, and you have to give it that meaning. So it's up to you. The tradition was that you believed in the narratives espoused by the authorities, the religious narratives, and they told you what the meaning of life was. God created the world, Adam and Eve, broke the commandment not to eat the fruit of the tree of knowledge of good and evil, and so they were kicked out of paradise, and ever since then, suffering until Jesus came to rescue us, and then at the second coming, we'll be able to live in paradise again. And there's a whole story there, and your role then is defined by the church as how you're supposed to live if you want to make sure your soul is saved, etc. So there's your narrative that tells you how to live. Or other religions, of course, would give you different stories of how to live, cooperation with nature, or cooperation with the gods, or whatever. But Darwin basically tells us, there's none of that's true. If anything, these kinds of stories evolve themselves in a back and forth dialectical process where the best religion wins, right? The same species, survival of the fittest. And the religion that survives is the survival of the fittest. This is why sociologists will argue that the major religions that we have today do excellent jobs in their social niches, addressing the needs of their members. That's why they got to be thousands of years old religions, and why they're so powerful and they have so many members, is because they've literally evolved the rituals and the beliefs that are really, really good, right? For their environment, right? But yes, they do compete with one another. You have religious wars, people trying to kill one another for the flag, for the cross. That's social Darwinism, which is actually Herbert Spencer. I should give you a quick look at Herbert Spencer. He's the one that gives us the survival of the fittest. Notice it says that right here. So even though we always, or at least you usually hear that with respect to Darwin, Darwin himself did not coin that expression, but Herbert Spencer did.
I'm also not sure that Darwin would have agreed with that comment either. My understanding of Darwin's findings is that he found that the fittest was not a necessary.
Well, it's a circular argument. Because how do you figure out who the fittest is? Well, they're the ones that have survived. And how do you figure out which ones survive? Well, they're the fittest. So that's not just a circular argument, it's an extremely circular argument. It's a viciously circular argument.
Darwin was about adaptation, so the species that was able to carry on progeny was the best, what was the most fit, if you will, to adapt to a change in the environment. So it was more about adaptation.
That doesn't mean that the society that develops liberalism and teaches people to think for themselves is necessarily the fittest society. It might actually be a society that beats them, that doesn't allow their people to do that.
History is written by the victor. Yeah.
So that's kind of an interesting. We like to think that we're the most evolved society on the face of the earth. You might visit Sweden and feel, well, wait a minute, Sweden seems to have their stuff together. With all the people we have, the mixture of people we have, the conflicts we have, Francis Fukuyama argues that that's exactly the way democracies behave. They get into a stalemate because it's designed to frustrate anyone who wants to take advantage of everyone else. And so it's basically a situation where no one gets their way. And that's very frustrating to everyone that wants to get their way, right? But Nietzsche looked at the meaning in life as coming from the ability to persuade the herd to believe you. So a perfect, he wouldn't have said this, of course, but a perfect example of this is Madonna, the singer, Madonna. She sings, some boys hug me, some boys kiss me, I think they're okay, yay. If they give me proper credit, I don't turn away, yay. Because I am, I am a material girl, right? I've screwed up the song. I can fix that.
That seems about right. But you're at least getting the idea through.
Cheerio. You know this one, right?
Yeah. First, I should stab him with it, Like you're good.
Madonna describes herself as a follower of Nietzsche.
For diners. Yeah, he thinks he can impress by giving him expensive gifts. It's nice though. You want it?
She doesn't just sing that her whole career, obviously. She switches to something else. And the problem is, you define your moral values, you define who you are, you define a moral narrative. In this case, she's the material girl. And once people accept that, you persuaded them, they pay you millions of dollars, they set you're a hit and everything. But then, if you keep singing that same song, not only will they get bored of you, but they also expect you to sing that song. And that means that instead of you being the one who creates meaning, you have to give them what you've been already giving them. In other words, you're under their control now, because you have to keep doing the same thing, right? And that's when life gets boring for the artist, is when they just have to keep doing the same thing over and over again, right? So what Nietzsche says is you have to keep creating new meaning. You can't just stay in the old meaningful story that you've created the first time. You have to create new meaning constantly. And so you come up with a new one, and you surprise everyone. So the next one, what, is American Girl or something? American Woman, I forget what it was. Then she becomes the world's best mother for a while, right? You know, that happens. She adopts some children, but she also raises her own child. Then she becomes the world's worst horseman, falls off the horse and breaks her hip or whatever it was. But she comes back. She's in her, what, 50s or so? And yet she's still dancing around on stages like she's 15 or whatever, right? So she keeps creating new meaning. So in a sense, she's a Nietzschean. She's always surprising people. You never know what to expect. That's an important part of a Übermensch, that you're the one that's always creating meaning for the others. Hitler clearly thought of himself as an Übermensch, and that is that he's the Führer, he's the one that delivers the meaningfulness to the society, etc. You'd say the same thing with folks like Trump, and not just Trump, but I think any presidential candidate wants to be able to deliver a meaningful narrative. You know, maybe it's yes, we can, right? You know, that might be a good narrative. Might be, what was Hillary's narrative? Anybody remember? I'm with her. Terrible narrative. Notice she didn't get elected, right? So the quality of your narrative, whether it grabs the soul of the society, is a very important piece of this. Can you imagine how Hillary must have felt when she didn't win? Imagine how Trump felt when he did win. He looked absolutely startled, didn't he? You remember? Remember seeing his face as he walked out on the stage claiming that he was the winner? Remember? Yes? You don't remember his face? Remember it? Kat and I were sitting there on the couch watching. Can't believe it, right?
That's terrifying.
Pardon?
Terrifying.
He does.
He's like, oh boy, what do I do now?
That wasn't part of the plan. We were just gonna lose and be angry, you know? Oh, what happened?
I love how Baron's like always mystified whenever you see him. He's always like, okay, what do we do now? Okay, I'm supposed to go over here.
But who else? Who else are the kind of Uber mention that I think Nietzsche is talking about? Because,
well, I was just going to mention when you were talking about the Madonna thing. One movie that reminds me of that idea is Gladiator, where Maximus goes through this whole trial of, you know, losing his family, losing everything, and so he's, you know, basically on the verge of suicide, and then he discovers, oh, I can please the crowd. And there's even this place where he's trying to, you know, kill everything. He kills everybody. He's like 1:5, and he kills everybody, and the crowd's just kind of like, yeah, okay, what else are you going to do? You know, so they, it's almost like, you know, he's like, aren't you entertained? Aren't you entertained? And he eventually builds to this, the Colosseum. So he continues to build on what his successes have been as fueled by the crowd, and eventually culminates with, well, I have nothing left to do except to kill Cassius in the arena. And then he kills Cassius and dies.
Yeah, I'm not sure that, of course, that was actually realistic. That's a great movie.
I don't think it was historically
perfect. Yeah.
No.
Yeah.
I think Cassius dies in a different way.
Although, I think the emperor was killed by his son. That much, I think, is...
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Marcus Aurelius.
Yeah, yeah. But besides people like that, I think artists in general are attempting have meaningful lives by their ability to convince people to think of whatever they made as art.
Isaac Asimov, possibly the most successful writer I've ever known, he's most famous for his science fiction work, but he wrote everything. He wrote fantasy work, textbook work,
book on the Bible,
biblical studies, but also reference material for scientific inventions and discoveries. He wrote literally everything under the damn sun, including just boring adventure novels under pseudonyms. I think maybe for the 20th century, at least in the United States, might have been the single most prolific writer that I can think of, over 1,000 publications in his lifetime. He kept it going one way or another. He had to give variety.
I mean, Duchamp, when he persuades people to accept his ready-mades as great art, even though what he's doing is saying it's anti-art in a sense, right? You know, so here's a urinal, ready-made. You know, it's, I didn't even make it; I just selected it, right?
It's a PR thing almost.
The accomplishment was in persuading people to believe it. You see it? The artist's accomplishment isn't going out to a store, finding a used urinal, grabbing it, and then bringing it to the museum and trying to pass it off as art. It's succeeding in passing it off as art. He's created meaning and persuaded the herd to believe it.
Right. He creates the narrative that makes it
right. Right, exactly. And that gives him a sense of fulfillment. Although, notice, you can't just stop there. You have to go on and come up with something else for the next time, and so on. And an awful lot of artists that you know, really think, what can I pass off as art? I'll take a crappy stepladder, wrap it with some hose, you know, and take it in and say, this is art, you know, and... Yeah, maybe they succeed. Maybe they get $1 million for their art. Maybe not. And I think an awful lot of the time the artist fails miserably because it's not because the piece that they've created is a shocker or not. Of course, it could be a shocker. A pile of grocery carts that you pulled out of a ditch. you know, take a picture of it, you know, this is art. No better than lots of other pieces I've seen, no worse. The real skill, though, is in persuasion that you know you use to accomplish convincing them and getting money for this travesty.
I think a couple of artists literally made a career out of making sure they gave a cheeky name to their piece more than the actual piece itself. Mm-hmm. It's a little bizarre, but sometimes that's the separator between somebody's hobby and a multi-million-dollar piece of artwork. Somebody gave it a name and somebody had to make it some kind of bizarre.
So artists, I think, try to be uber-mention, and it gives them a sense of fulfillment if they succeed in persuading people. They could even become quite rich. Businessmen that create a new business persuades you to think that Instagram is going to be an absolutely essential necessity for your daily, you know, intake of information or whatever. You can imagine that as what an Ubermensch is. But also, I think, just believing that it's your opportunity, your responsibility to choose meaning for yourself. And remember when in the United States, the government says, what's your religious preference? And you believe that you have the right to choose your religious preference. That's what a religion would consider a heretical belief, that you can make your own decision, right? Traditionally, the church tells you this is what God did, this is what your obligation is, et cetera, et cetera. Show up at church or else, you know, and no opportunity for you to decide for yourself. Oh, I don't believe that. Or I believe this, 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 and that, but no, I don't believe this part. You know, no, they don't give you that opportunity. That's heresy for you to start thinking on your own. That's where you end up with the comfy chair, right? You know, is that?
Yeah.
This is heresy, you know. But I don't understand what you're talking about. Everybody know the comfy chair reference? No. Yes. No.
Oh,
yes.
Oh, I definitely.
We can do comfy chair.
Oh yes. Yes. Please do. Yes. Yes.
It's a good transition.
Strong because you can survive the soft cushions. Miggles, put her in the comfy chair! Now, you will stay in the comfy chair until lunchtime, with only a cup of coffee at 11. I think that doesn't make it worth my shopping. Confess!
So that's the comfy chair reference. Check the internet, it's famous and stupid. But no one expects the Spanish Inquisition, so that might be why it's supposed to be funny. Actually, I think it's more serious than that. The Spanish Inquisition was supposed to torture people with really miserable devices. Yes, and so, but if you think, well, the church is concerned about saving your soul, and your soul is attached to your body. The trouble with the body is loaded with sinful tendencies. The only way for you to save your soul is to restrict your body's ability to engage in pleasurable things, right? So the body's worst thing that it does is enjoy itself, because that's what endangers your soul. That's why you whip yourself, right? You know, you've seen, actually there's lots of religions that encourage members to, you know, beat their bodies and fast, make your body suffer to show the body who's in charge, mind over matter, right? You know, so asceticism is treating your body in a way that makes sure it knows who's in charge. Your soul is in charge, not the body. So, in a way, they're playing on that, I think, in order to make it seem like, well, you know, the right kind of torture then would be to give you pleasure, because that will make your soul endangered, right? You think?
This actually makes
I could ask that as the first quiz. Did I already ask the quiz question? Why did the Spanish Inquisition cardinals use the comfy chair as torture? Why did these cardinals, right, they're supposed to be cardinals, Roman Catholic cardinals, not birds, by the way. I asked this quiz question once, and someone emailed me a response as if she thought that the cardinals I referred to were the red birds. And she was convinced that, well, red birds don't like comfortable chairs. So why do the cardinals use the comfy chair as torture? And by the way, you'll find it a discussion on the internet if you're curious about the kinds of things people wonder about.
Well, this is just offering this as a counterpoint. This is the same group of cardinals who use the rack. So, not quite the
correct By the way, an interesting point in all of this is that when the Inquisition was started, those were educated bishops and cardinals that were sent to the villages, where the villages were about ready to kill lots of people sometimes because they suspected them of being heretics. And so one of the things that actually occurred was that the cardinals would get there and keep the town from killing, you know, mass murders, you know, of people that they suspected. And, you know, they would put trial, you know, put people on trial, ask them questions, and determine, no, they're not. So don't kill them, right? So they actually were an advance, a judicial advance on what the medieval villages had, instead of the horror that they were horrible compared to modern times as a judiciary system, but they were way better than what they had before. So it was actually progress. Interesting argument. Right, right. You know, so this was, at least these are sane people that come in and actually perform a real judicial ritual, ask questions. By the way, they kept records. So you could actually read the records of the interviews that they did, like in Spain. So that's just for fun. But let me get back to Nietzsche. So Nietzsche becomes a professor, one of the youngest ever, in his early 20s, ends up being a professor in Basel, Switzerland. Becomes horrified, though, with the routine, ends up realizing that it's not for him, and he wants to leave, so he does. Ends up going to Switzerland, to a little town, famous village where like Heidi was filmed, I think, and you know that kind of thing. A beautiful mountainous kind of village. And that's where he writes Also Sprach Zarathustra. And the theme is this prophet comes down from the hill, which, you know, if you look at this little village, you know, it's nestled in the mountains. You can just picture him coming down. The fact that they have the house there, it's Nietzsche's house where he stayed in the room where he wrote the books.
Nietzsche 4 Temmuz 1881 Pazartesi günü Sis Maria'ya ilk görüşte aşık oldu. Buranın dağları ve ormanları en hayat dolu fikirlerine ilham verecekti. Sis Maria'nın güzelliği, onu varlığın saf muhteşemliği konusunda...
That little village is where he wrote most of the books, I guess, on the speaker. So it's one book, but within it it's got several books, right? So he wrote those there. So he comes down, and this is where Zoroaster or Zarathustra says, God is dead, and we have killed it. And the people are looking at this guy, what on earth are you talking about? And you think of him as a nut, and he realizes, I've come too soon. These people aren't ready for this information. But what does Nietzsche mean when he says God is dead? We have killed him. Well, number one, he's quoting from Martin Luther, who points out that God is dead. Who is Jesus, right? Jesus dies on the cross. Why did Jesus die on the cross? By the way, he's God, right? And he dies for our sins. So basically, we've killed God, right? And this is a motif. There's lots of opportunities for you to see God's being killed in sacrifice in one way or another. In any case, what Nietzsche doesn't mean, obviously, is that we've like sneaked some kind of thermonuclear device out of the universe and managed to hit God somewhere and actually kill God. That's just ridiculous. Of course not. What he's talking about is the narrative, the traditional narrative tells us that there is a God, God created the world, God wants us to do this, that, and the other thing, and if so, then we'll be rewarded, etc. Well, so that's the story, and people needed God in order for them to believe in the morals and the authority of the church, and this is why we... So they needed God, right? But what happens once we get into the Enlightenment, the modern times, we realize that these narratives are man-made, evolutionarily fighting one another and so on. May the best religious narrative win, may the best movie win, you know, etc. We realize, well, none of these are true, and so we end up meaningless. God is dead. We have killed him. In other words, we've killed the narratives, the traditional narratives that tell us that there is a God. We've killed those. So God, in that sense, is dead. We no longer need it. Instead, you are God, because you get to vote on what your values are. You get to, so if we're arguing over abortion, as we were talking about last week, right? You know, we're in a society that feels like we can vote on whether or not we want abortion to be legal or not. You know, the conflict over approving Kavanaugh for the Supreme Court is motivated, so they say, by the belief that if he gets onto the Supreme Court, that will tip the balance and we'll end up going backwards, if you're a progressive, and retreat from the idea that women have the right to have an abortion if they choose. We'll reverse that and go back to the view, right? You get it, right? We've got this competing narrative, which should we vote for? We think of it as something that we should vote for, that the rights that we give to one another are the rights that we choose. The moral values that we believe we ought to follow are the ones that we choose. Those are all choices that an Ubermensch can make. I mean, if you grew up in a church and believe that the church tells you what's right and wrong, you have no thought that you get to vote on what those moral values ought to be, because the church tells you what they are. And they're the authority, they know. You believe them, you're a believer, you believe them. But the trouble with an Ubermensch is you have to make the choice. You choose the moral values that you want to live by. Yes? So in a sense, as Americans, we're certainly uber-mentioned, as Nietzsche would have described it. And I think Francis Fukuyama picks that up with his book, The Last Man. It's the end of history in The Last Man. But who's the last man? That's Nietzsche's phrase, the last man, right? Because that's what happens once everyone becomes an uber-mensch, right? So, what else? There's lots of stuff. I should really do this for you too. How many of you have seen 2001, A Space Odyssey? Oh, that's pretty good. Most of you, actually. He's thinking about the monolith. How many of you can tell that that's just a man in an ape suit? But this movie was made in 1968.
But this, the effects for the time were monumental. It's damn.
I know. Today you see like a Star Wars movie and you see the Wookiees. I'm absolutely convinced Wookiees.
This is really not bad for 1968. Actually, it basically took until Star Wars until something like that. Really,
heard this music before? You know that this is Thus Speaks Zarathustra by Richard Strauss. So this music comes from Richard Strauss's poem, which is based on Nietzsche's book. Becomes a tool user. And of course, within a day, ends up being murdered. Notice that the whole troop have all learned how to use. Fighting over the water hole. Take a break. Any questions? Is this fun? Is this entertaining? Did I cover important stuff?
Are you not entertained?
It's the